Let's do a show. Let's do a show right now. What are we doing?
Can't you see? Everyone, they're here already. You're next.
Let's go. Welcome to the future, where the glass is half full and you'll need new glasses, where you'll be jumping from conclusions.
The past is annulled, and a new future is born.
Never before in history has so much meant so little to so many. AD on the radio.
So, you know, last week, finished up the final show of the week. I think we got preempted in some markets by like soccer or something. And we go, well, that's the end of our broadcast week. It's been a slow news week. There's no more news left that's going to happen this week. Cool. Moment we get off the air, Don Rickles dies. Barry Manilow comes out of the closet and Trump bombs Syria. The hell, man. So we got a little backtracking to do and some stuff to cover. I think the thing that was the, well, it was, if you are like me, it was a nail biter when Trump went ahead and cruise missiled that airbase in Syria. It was, of course, a response to the horrific chemical attack on Syrian civilians earlier in the week. And did you see the pictures? Did you see the pictures of the children suffering the results of a horrific chemical attack, thanks to a brutal dictator, Assad. You see those pictures? Oh, it was one of those things. Like if you saw that and did not cry, then you're a stronger, more stiff, upper-lipped individual than I am. It was one of those things, I can't remember the news network, but they were like, hey, just FYI, we're going to show you some stuff. And 9 times out of 10, when they do that, I'm like, this will be no big. This is whatever. This is just trying to use a little bit of shock, them trying to use a little shock value to get you to stick around through the commercial. And then I saw it. I was like, oh my God. And so Trump ordered, like I said, 60 cruise missiles to be fired at an airbase in Syria. And let's be real here, bit of a shift. Only because I think it was back in 2013. I'm horrible with dates. But do you remember? Do you remember Trump going off on Twitter against the idea that Barack Obama might attack Syria? I'm looking at one of the tweets now. Again, to our very foolish leader, do not attack Syria. If you do, many very bad things will happen from that fight, and the U.S. gets nothing. And look, I don't know how you feel about the action the U.S. took in Syria. There's all sorts of people saying like, no, this is not our fight. Come on, you were against us. This is hypocritical of you. Other people saying this is a show of strength. This is showing that the U.S. will not be trifled with. And if you're like me, you go, apparently you didn't get the big old thumbs up from Congress before you did this. And that's in America. So whether this was the right thing to do or not. Oh, and by the way, there's audio of Hillary Clinton saying that there are when asked about Syria, Hillary Clinton said, wouldn't go to war with them, but there are air bases that they use to distribute chemical weapons that we should take out. See if I can find that audio and play it for you, because what she described she would do in terms of dealing with Syria was exactly what Donald Trump did. But like we said, he did it without the big old AOK from Congress. And if you're like me, that makes you more than a little antsy. Because if you're going to do something like this, if you're going to look at a horrific dictator like Assad who's doing terrible things to civilians and go, hey, there are international agreements that say what you're doing to your own people are not okay And we can't just turn a blind eye to the fact that you are flaunting the rules that we, the civilized world, have tried to set up for one another. There's many people that say that was the right thing to do. Back when Obama was talking about doing it, back when Clinton was talking about doing it, plenty of people on the left were saying, yeah, go for it. This is a human rights issue. Go for it. Now those people on the left are saying, his numbers were in a tailspin. That's why he decided to cruise missile Syria. There's lots of different opinions. There was a moment, though, when it happened that absolutely, if you're like me, it made you hold your breath. I think the whole world held its breath for a second there. Why? Well, it's an interesting situation. It affects all of us, and we'll get into it next. Say ho, ho,
say ho, whoa, ho, whoa. Let's start the show. Let's start the show. Let's start the show. Real radio.
104.1. Where the left and right come together for fundamental truths. AD on the radio, on Twitter at ADSXE.
So, when Trump ordered the cruise missile attack on Syrian air bases, the places that were allegedly used to distribute chemical weapons, the places where the chemical weapons that Assad used against his own people were distributed from. It was an interesting contradiction. Only because a few short years ago, Trump was tweeting all about how it would be incredibly foolish of Obama to do exactly what he did. And there are people on the left saying, like, this is human rights issue. You can't allow this to happen to people. And people on the right. I think traditionally speaking, people on the right, who are all for military spending and things of that nature, love any opportunity to point at the left and go, look, you call us the warmongers, but really they're the warmongers. Look at our warmongering president. Look at Hillary licking her chops. She can't wait to go blow the living bejesus out of some other country because that's what she wants. She's got so much blood on her hands and she's going to have more on her hands and she just can't wait to nuke places. That's what warmonger Hillary wants. That was a reaction to folks on the left like Obama and Hillary talking about it. And now those same people are going, good. Donald J. Trump has shown that he's not one to be trifled with. America doesn't mess around. And if you mess around, if you pull the bear by its tail, it's going to, I don't know. You going to get in trouble for not obeying international treaties? Does Dolly Parton sleep on her back? America, way to go, Trump. These are the same people calling Hillary and Obama warmongers. And conversely, people on the left who are saying, this is a human rights issue, and I'm so glad that we have a president, and Hillary Clinton is, we have a president, and we have a Hillary Clinton right around the corner waiting to do the right thing by the people of Syria. And now they're like, oh, look at Trump warmongering. Look at him trying to distract from the fact that his poll numbers are slipping. It's just the thing that blew my mind was the hypocrisy of the situation on both sides. Blew my mind. Now, if you're like me, you went, oh, he did this without the big thumbs up, like we said, from Congress. He did this without going, hey, Congress, we okie-dokie with this. I'm going to, you know, I got these 60 cruise missiles burning a hole in my back presidential pocket. I'm just going to go to town on some Syrian air bases. How do you feel about that? Apparently that wasn't done. And if Trump is doing this, if Trump did this without the say-so from Congress here in America, that's what made me nervous. You're going to take action like this. And look, we won't know all these things. So maybe he did. But I really hope the old Donald J. got on the phone with world leaders and said, FYI, this is happening. Apparently, he did it with Russia and said, I know you're allied with Assad, but let's get your folks out of there because we're going to take some action against these chemical weapons supplies and against the airfields that are used to distribute chemical weapons. And The folks over in Russia said, what chemical weapons? No, that was no, that was a leak from a chemical plant. No, yet, comrade. So I hope he got on the phone, and I hope he got world leaders on the same page. And I understand that a big part of this is a show of strength and a show of the idea that America is not to be trifled with. That's the people that do like this seem to appreciate that. For me, it made me go, that's Russia's ally that you're attacking. And if you haven't gotten the approval of Congress, maybe you haven't thought this all the way through. And this is why you, me, all of us, when we found out that happened, went, that was a question. How are the Russians going to respond? How are the Russians going to respond? And so far, so good. Russia didn't like what Trump did, but it didn't plunge us into the global Armageddon that some people were afraid of. Now, if you're like me, you hope that anything that happens within that region is extraordinarily well thought out. Why? Well, cast your mind back to Saddam Hussein. Like Assad, not a good guy. Horrible, awful, evil, brutal dictator that deserved what he had coming to him. But these rebels, I think it's interesting. These words get bandied around, and America has done it time and time again. Armed rebels. Armed and aided freedom fighters. I can't remember which Rambo movie it was, but did you see the Rambo movies? Do you remember at the end of them? One of the Rambo movies was dedicated to the valiant rebel freedom fighters. Funkhouser, could you look this up? Find the exact quote. But I think one of the Rambo movies was dedicated to the valiant rebel freedom fighters, the Taliban. That was an oopsie moment. Reagan described them as freedom fighters. So we learned from the jihadists, from the Islamic State, from the wannabe caliphate, that when you do something like leave a power vacuum after offing a brutal dictatorship, that leaves it up to a power grab. Now, who do you think's all set to grab that power based on history? It's a scary thought, and we'll discuss it next.
For more stimulation and less irritation, 9 out of 10 doctors choose KPRC AM 950. Houston's more stimulating talk radio.
Don't get the blues, get all the news. We mean all of you guys out there in radio land.
All aboard!
He's back. AD on the radio.
Give it up, yeah. Give it up, yeah. Bring this on, bring this on. Come on, come on.
It was, I think it was Rambo 3, the one, like the Rambo movie that, hold on. Yeah. basically, they changed it. They changed it. But the, when Rambo 3 first came out, and this is an oversight on the part of the filmmakers, but really it's indicative of a constant oversight that our leaders, the suits in Washington that decide how the rest of our lives are going to go, put the word leaders in sarcastic air quotes if you feel the way I do. But it's indicative of an oversight that they've made time and time again. This film is dedicated to, I think it said, the brave freedom fighters, the Taliban in Afghanistan. And then later on, they went, okay, This film is dedicated to the gallant people of Afghanistan. An after-the-fact edit was necessary when the folks that made Rambo 3 discovered that the people that they dedicated their movie to were essentially jihad terrorists. But at the time, they seemed like brave rebel freedom fighters. It's that word, rebel. I think it's from Star Wars. You just associate rebel with the good guys. They're rebels. Oh, cool. Like Skywalker and Leia. Well, let's throw in with them. But you get into a situation, and hopefully it is selective airstrikes, and hopefully this is a human rights issue, and hopefully it is just to disable the air bases from which Assad launches his chemical attacks against his own people. But getting any deeper into it, you get rid of Assad. You think there's not going to be a jihadist power grab in Syria? And this is why folks like Donald Trump in 2013 were saying this, there's nothing for America here. And you could make the situation much, much worse. Remember what happened with Saddam Hussein. Remember what happened. What are we looking down the barrel of now, thanks to the fact that we deinstalled a brutal dictator? Oh, growing jihad and hatred against America. A power grab that resulted in religious extremists that want to, well, wipe us from the face of the map, gaining some ground. Donald J. Trump back in June of 2013 said we should stay the hell out of Syria. The, quote, rebels are just as bad as the current regime. What will we get for our lives and billions of dollars? Zero. He also said, remember, all these freedom fighters in Syria want to fly planes into our buildings. When someone asked if he'd go, he said, no, dopey. I would not go into Syria. But if I did, it would be by surprise and not blurted out all over the media like fools. Let the Arab League take care of Syria. Why are these rich Arab countries not paying us for the tremendous cost of such an attack? All cogent, valid points. Now, look, when you saw those pictures of the children dying as a result of Assad's chemical attack against his own people, did that tear a hole in your heart? Did you cry? I cried. There's absolutely no way it was possible for me to hold back tears when I saw that. And if it was just a series of surgical strikes against air bases, then maybe something like that was necessary. Maybe something like that was necessary. Maybe Assad needed to hear a message that the world would not stand for these types of attacks that took the lives of innocent children. Maybe that was necessary. But I really, really hope, really, really hope that behind the scenes, because it doesn't seem like he did from the outside looking in, I really, really hope that from his perspective, Trump took the time to get world leaders on the same page, that there was some sort of intelligent expectation that these actions would not plunge us into global Armageddon with Russia. And if they are, like I said, just surgical strikes against sites that allow Assad to commit war crimes against his own people, well, that's one thing. But if it's an attempt to overthrow a brutal dictatorship and install a new regime, and take our best shot at nation building. Historically, how do you feel like that's worked out? Anyways, all of this is neither here nor there. The thing that really struck me about all of it, and I hope it was your takeaway too, was, like I said, the level of hypocrisy involved. And people will be like, hey, Trump was just doing what he had to do. He's being a strong president. It's not just Trump. It is not. It's people. It It's the American people. I think it was the hypocrisy of the American people that upset me so much. People on the left, unbelievably hypocritical in saying that, oh, when Obama was going to do it, when Hillary was talking about it, it was the right thing to do. It was the morally upright thing to do. When Trump did it, it was horrible, awful, evil. People on the right saying, ugh, warmongering Obama and Hillary want to plunge us into World War III. They're allies of the Taliban. That's why they want to take out Assad. The Taliban's trying to take over. Jihad is trying to take over Syria. And they're trying to help them do it. Barack Hussein Obama, does that mean anything to you? Mm-hmm. And now, same people going, yeah, we got a strong president who proves that you don't mess with the US of A. We'll put a boot in your ass. So the hypocrisy of politicians is unsurprising to me, unsurprising to you, me, all of us. The ability they have to turn on a dime, to contradict themselves, to say just the right thing to keep them alive for the next 10 minutes in the polls. That's not a new song and dance to anybody that's paid any shred of attention for any amount of time. But the way Americans, ordinary people, you, me, all of us, seem so quick to turn on their heels and do a complete 180 in terms of their core beliefs just because of how this went down, who was responsible, who had their finger on the button, really, really made me check myself. And made me want to ask you to do the same thing for yourself. Your principles are your principles. Who you are at your core is all you've got at the end of the day. Please don't give it to someone else. Please don't give it to a politician that doesn't know your name. Wouldn't know you in the street. If they ran over you. In their federally financed limos. Please don't give up who you are. Don't sell your soul just so you can trumpet on about something. It's okay. It's okay to be against things like cruise missiles. It's okay to be against things like attacks against Syrian airfields. It's okay. All of this is okay. And you know what? It's okay if you change your mind on it. But don't sell yourself out. Please know yourself to your own heart be true. Don't sell yourself out just because of where this information is coming from. A lot of people are upset about the state of America, the state of politics. They were upset during the Obama regime. They're upset during the Trump regime. Hypocrisy, fake news, whatever you want to call it, misinformation, a dumbing down of our political process, elections won based on snarky Facebook comments, a society run by Twitter. You have every right to be upset about these things. And all these things that are happening in Washington. Little town where decisions are being made about the vast majority of our lives are happening on the regular. That are not in our best interest. That are not in your best interest. That involve spineless hypocrites speaking for you and taking half your paycheck. You want those people to be different and change. You want those people to be people of principle. But I'm telling you, if you don't have the strength of your own convictions, if you don't have a knowledge of what is right and what is wrong for you in your heart, if you don't have the backbone to stick to your principles, if we all fail to have the backbone to stick to our principles, then all is lost. All right, Funkhouser, let's awkwardly transition into entertainment news now. You ready for that?
This is My Witness News. In no way, shape, or form fair and certainly not balanced. And now, super producer to the stars, Barry Funkhouser.
Well, all right then.
Yeah.
I guess so.
Yeah.
Hey,
but you know, the good news is the the good news is we're all still here. You know, like after we launched those missile strikes against Syrian air bases, and well, their conspicuous ally, the Russians, appear to be equipped to get after it in the same way against us in a retaliatory way. Something that a lot of I think the Russian response was what everyone was worried about the second it happened. At least everybody I spoke to, like, what? How's Putin going to respond to us cruise missiling his allies? And we're all still here, so that's a good thing. That's a good and happy thing. And also, did I hear about what? What else is going on?
Well, you know, my namesake, Barry Manilow.
Oh. Wait, hold on. You were named after Barry Manilow?
I was. My mom was channel surfing, and he was performing, and she goes, oh, I like that name. That'll be my son's name.
How far along was she at the time?
Oh, I don't know. Probably pretty late on.
Uh-huh. You were named after Barry Manilow?
Yes, and Richard Chamberlain.
What?
Yeah, I still
is your
have
middle
to...
name...
Yeah,
is
Richard.
Your middle name is Richard?
Uh-huh.
Barry Dick Funkhouser?
Mm-hmm.
Huh.
Go ahead.
It's a great name. No, it's a great name. I got nothing. It's a great name. Barry Richard Funkhouser. And you know what? Here's the thing. Barry Manilow, incredibly talented, gifted guy. I have nothing bad to say about him. Do I listen to a bunch of his music? No. But I love the fact that that guy was a hardworking jingle writer, like a real working musician. You know, he, what did he write? He wrote tons and tons of jingles
Band-Aids.
Back in the day. I'm stuck on a Band-Aid, and a Band-Aid stuck on me. That was the work of the great Baza Manilow, as we used to say in England. Boy, Baza. So what about your namesake, Barry Manilow?
He came out of the closet.
Oh!
Da, da, da.
And may I add, possibly the most poorly constructed closet in the history of mankind. You know what, Funkhouser?
Oh, you knew?
I now know the exact same number of things I knew before you told me this. I had an inkling. In fact, did you see our friend? It was a big week for Steve Hofstetter, our comic friend that's been on the show many, many times. I'm sitting there watching the Mets game, and the great Gary Cohen, the guy that calls the Mets games on SNY, was like, hey, check out Steve Hofstetter's new podcast over at SNY.TV where he talks about the Mets. So I was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. They just said Hofstetter's name during the Mets game. That's so cool. So cool. But I guess Steve Hofstetter has known Barry Manilow's husband for like 20 years because he's in a 40-year relationship. And he was like, so great that this couple that's completely devoted to each other can be a couple now. This is awesome news. More on Baza Manilow next. You walk these streets most every day. You're waiting to get washed away. Real Radio. Real Radio.
More AD on the radio.
So like I said, we thought the work week was over. We're like, it was a good week of shows, Funkhouser. We're being preempted here, and there's a best of running there. And, all right, cool. Well, it's been a slow news week. It's not like anything's going to happen. Then Don Rickles dies. Barry Manilow comes out of the closet. And Trump cruise missiled Syria. So some stuff happened,
oh,
and we had a lot of ground to make up this week. But yeah, Barry Manilow out of the closet. Let's continue with the news.
Okay. Drake. Yeah, what?
Well, hold on. More about Barry Manilow.
About Bear?
Well, no, because like our buddy Steve Hofstetter, I saw a tweet from him, and I guess he's known Barry Manilow's husband for a long time, like 20 years or something. And Barry Manilow has been, I don't know how long they've been married, but he's been in a relationship with his husband for 40 years, I think now. I don't know how old Barry Manilow is at this stage in the game, but he's been with this guy for a long time. And Hofstetter said something really nice. He was like, I'm so glad that two people are so devoted to each other can now be openly devoted. But Barry Manilow said, like, was this ever a question for you, Funkhouser?
I've known about him my whole life.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. Like when someone says you're named after this person, you're probably likely to take a closer look at him than the rest of us. Like,
I think eventually just kind of put it all together and went, oh, okay. Once I, figured out what was going on.
Hmm. can you play Mandy?
Do you want Mandy?
I love that song.
Me too.
I love that song. I never even knew that song existed until, do you remember the Thanksgiving episode of The Simpsons? Oh, Margie, you came and you gave me a turkey on my vacation away from worky. It was great. But, like, could there ever have been any, like...
He's the best. Best there ever was. Is.
Beautiful.
I remember all my life, raining down as cold as ice, shadows of a man, a face through a window, crying in the night. The night goes into morning, just another day. Happy people pass my way.
Beautiful. Setting a scene, words like poetry, painting a vivid picture. Oh, here we go. Incredible. Ah, beautiful. I mean, there's been all sorts of highly obvious jokes made about man and D and how those two things play off each other in this song. But, like, just, yeah, can't front. Barry Manilow.
You can't front about Bear.
No, you can't. You really can't. I'm inadvertently doing Christopher Walken impersonations now. No. But, like, was there ever any question whatsoever that, like, did anybody not realize he was gay? Because, like, it was a big thing to not come out for that long. He said he was really disappointed. He was really concerned that he would disappoint his fans. I'm like, your fans know. Your fans are very aware of this and have been for some time. Like, I feel bad for the guy that he hasn't been able to live his life out loud for 40 years.
Bear does what he wants.
To find somebody, maybe he had an ulterior motive. Like, Well, I'm just saying, like, he's been with this one guy for like 40 years. And if you are an entertainer of Barry Manilow's stature, you are going to be able to get yourself a little sweet loving on the side on the road on a regular basis. And so I wonder if maybe there was like an alternative motive. Like he's sitting there with his husband, like, no, now's not the time. People can't know I'm with anyone. Allowed him to go out on the road for 40 years being like, how you doing? Are you in a committed relationship? No. You ever seen me with someone? No, you haven't. I wonder. It's a horrible thing to say.
We'll have to ask Hofstetter when we see him again.
Yeah, and I think a big part of the reason that, part of the reason why he came out was like, someone had proof. Like, for all these years, there hadn't been conclusive proof that Barry Manilow was gay. And there was, like, a danger of him getting... What is it when someone outs you in the entertainment industry? Because it happened to Lance Bass. It's called being lanced when someone outs you without you being ready to do it. He was afraid that he was going to get lanced. And and that's why he came out. And it's sad to me that the only reason he felt it necessary to come out was because he thought someone was going to expose him. I don't know. I hope he feels like it's awesome. I think his the back end of the situation is that he said, now it's happened. It's great.
Okay,
we should really move along now. Does explain why Mike Pence spent the last week or so frantically deleting songs out of his iTunes playlist. Go on.
Drake's in the news. His workout plan involves no pasta and lots of burpees.
Oh, I have a similar
plan.
I have a similar workout plan, but it just involves lots of pasta and burping. Go on.
Friend star David Schwimmer has separated from his wife. Aww.
Oh, irreconcilable differences stemming from the fact that she insists on introducing him as friend star David Schwimmer. And then he's obligated to go, hi. Did you see Matthew Perry was on like The View or The Talk or one of those shows the other day? And they're like, oh, you were really funny when you were on Friends. And some yuck of a host was like, could you have been any more funny? And he was like, well, I've never heard that one before. I was like, way to roll with the punches, dude.
Leave the stimulation to the professionals.
Everyone is so smart.
KBRC, more stimulating talk radio.
There's something happening here, and you should know what it is.
The dumbing up of America.
Now, more AD on the radio.
All right, Funkhouser. What else is going on in the news?
Hold on.
Let me just congratulate you on one of your smoother transitions just there.
Aww. Curse Sweet. You, wretched computer.
Go on. What
Mama
else?
June. Yeah, buddy. She says no one will ever see her in a bikini.
Well, unless the CIA needs a new torture technique. No, I mean, like...
Did you see the new Mama June?
Yeah, I've seen the new Mama June, and, like, what are your thoughts on that?
Okay, sure. Whatever makes you happier, I guess.
Look, whether you find her attractive or not, the bottom line is she's very thin now, especially compared to what she used to be, and she looks completely different. And... like, it's one of those things where people are like, oh, it's such an inspirational transformation. And look, this did not happen without some work on her part. But it was for some sort of reality show, like some sort of extreme makeover type situation. And like, basically what happened was she bought herself a new head. Like, she went into a plastic surgeon's office and said, slice and dice me until there's much less of me and I look completely different. And people are like, oh, it's such an inspiring transformation. I'm like, is it though? Is it like inspiring is... maybe sort of, I don't know, working with what you got, accepting who you are and becoming the best version of that. And so, like, on the one hand, it's an incredible transformation. It's kind of cool for people to know that I guess anything is possible. But, you know, I've got these visions of people being inspired to do all the wrong things by shows like this one. I don't know. Yeah. That's all I have to say about that.
I guess so, but she still...
Mama June looks very different. I don't think that she's setting a great example with the way she got there. But let's be real here. If you're looking to Mama June to set a great example, and that's the benchmark by which you are living your life, well, you already have other sets of problems. So there you go. What were you saying, Funkhouser?
Oh, nothing. I can't remember now. Just, you know.
Oh,
I saw
you got to hold on to these.
Well, you know, I was at the grocery store, you know, looking at the rag mags. Isn't that what they're called? And then there's a picture of the new Mama June's face and next to the old Mama June's face. Uh-huh. And I just, you know, I just felt uncomfortable altogether.
Hmm. If you covered one of those up, would you have felt less or more uncomfortable? Like, new Mama June versus old Mama June, if you only saw one of those things, how would that go?
I don't know. Is it fake news? Is it Photoshop? Like, I'm just...
No, it's not Photoshop. It's like... Well, I'm sure there is Photoshop. No, there's I'm sure there's Photoshop involved, but there's also like she really, really went under the knife. Like, she, like, I, and I will learn all about exactly what she did when her new show comes out. I don't know what it's called, but, like, all will be revealed. But it's not just Photoshop. It's, you know, it's live and in-person Photoshop. Like, instead of digitally shaving off, you know, like, parts of her butt, they actually sort of shaved off parts of her butt. Okay, all right. I'm trying to have lunch later. Let's stop talking about Mama June's butt shavings. Go on.
Hollywood is preparing for a writer's strike.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm out of here. Bye.
Yeah. If the strike happens, movie studios might have to do the unthinkable. Finally, consider doing a remake. Yeah. Well, here's the thing about the Hollywood writer's strike is, like, people are just like, you make so much money writing for TV and movies. How could you possibly want more? And they're going, well, you know, we're kind of like the creative engine that makes all this stuff happen. Without us, you know, like they're saying to the movie studios, no us, no you. Let's be real here. And we would like that fiscally recognized. So it could be an interesting one. When the last writer's strike happened, was that when reality TV really took off? Because reality television requires no writers. And a lot of people would say, I think there's, you know, like during the writer's strike, they're like, well, how are we going to get around this? Reality TV. And a lot of people will tell you reality TV is written. It's clearly not real, but it's an interesting workaround where reality TV shows are very, very cheap to make. You don't have to pay the stars, because this is supposed to be reality. It's documentary, so they don't get sort of like union minimum or whatever it is. And you don't have to pay the people that create the shows like writers get paid, because writers get paid really, really well. Even though they want to be paid more, they're already compensated more than adequately to get by. The bucks are good in writing for movies and television once you get up in the game. But what's interesting is, yeah, have you ever been around a reality show when it's being made, Funkhouser?
Not that I can recall.
Except
the one I was on.
What you have is a storyline developing, and then producers who are not writers essentially creatively steering it, like saying to the people, like, hey, you know, what's your favorite food, honey boo boo? Is it butter and sketty? Well, yeah. Well, say butter and sketty. Butter and sketty. Like, and then you got your stuff. And so it's kind of being improvised and written live as it goes without actually using a writer. And so all these things that reality shows have make them, that's why there's so freaking many of them. Like, they're not expensive to make. They're like low budget productions that clear a lot of cash on the back end, because you don't have to pay union rates for all the people that are on the show. You don't have to pay SAG and AFTRA and all that sort of stuff. And you do not, as it turns out, or at least I don't think you have to pay SAG and AFTRA. I could be wrong on that one. But technically, these are documentaries. So when you're making a documentary, you get all sorts of weird access to things that you wouldn't ordinarily get if you were making a for-profit thing. It's a weird, weird loophole with reality shows. And I think it all started last time there was a writer's strike. So every time you see these shows and go, do we really need another one of these? And like, yeah, because even if there's a tiny percentage of people watching them, like, the back end, the cash is still really good. Low budget stuff doesn't require slam dunk ratings to wind up being profitable. What else?
Amazon won a bidding war to stream Thursday Night Football.
Yeah, the way Thursday Night Football is viewed next season moving forward is going to be totally different. So congratulations to Amazon. Great news for all you Amazon subscribers who will now get the privilege of watching the 16th most interesting football game of the week when that begins again. Thursday Night Football. Mm. Yay. Go on.
Are you ready for some buffering?
Oh, very good, Funkhouser. Oh, my gosh. So I'm watching the Mets game yesterday on ESPN, which is a travesty to begin with. Like, when you have ESPN broadcasters mispronouncing Mike Piazza's name, this is a guy that went into the Hall of Fame last year. Was it last year? I think it was last year. Yeah, Mike Piazza went into the... So it's just like, you know, he's not some old school guy whose name you kind of have to check yourself on. And by the way, if you're doing MLB broadcasting for ESPN, you shouldn't have to check yourself on anything. You should do your due diligence and know what the hell is coming out of your mouth before it comes out of your mouth. But when they mispronounced Mike Piazza's name on ESPN yesterday, I was like, what the hell, man? What the hell? And then I realized that the ESPN feed of the game was, and like people all over Twitter were complaining about it. They're like, it's 30 seconds behind. So like the Mets Twitter, hey, Asdrubal Cabrera hit a double. Well, you know that from the Mets Twitter 30 seconds before it actually happens on TV. And then, you know, it's garbage. It's really garbage. So the idea of watching streaming sports, like buffering, not knowing what's happening in real time, if Twitter is beating your broadcast, well, hello, welcome to irrelevance. I was, you know what? I'm just salty about it because, I mean, we won the game, which was great. But when the Florida Marlins got their two runs, I was like, I found out on Twitter, and then 30 seconds later, I had to watch it happen on TV in front of me. So I had to live that moment twice. I was like, oh, the horror. But we won anyway, so let's go Mets, and it all worked out. But still, I was like, that's an interesting problem you're going to run up against when you get into streaming sports. I mean, I think a lot of people have ESPN. Like, people were saying it, they were like, I watch it through an app, but like, other people were watching it through their cable provider, and they're like, no, ESPN's still 30 seconds behind everything. Watching streaming football on Amazon, unless they are lickety freaking split with that stuff, I could see that. If you're the type of person that has your phone next to you while you play and you get alerts, it's not a satisfying experience. What else?
Tony Romo.
Oh, speaking of unsatisfying football experiences, what about Tony Romo? Go on.
He's got a new gig calling games for CBS.
Yeah, until Dak Prescott wants it. Aw. What else?
Michael Irvin denies he sexually assaulted a woman.
Well, you know, thank God he's retired because this would destroy his NFL career. That he never sexually assaulted a woman. I think it's like part of the league qualifications at this point in the game. Like all these, like Roger Goodell, the NFL like commissioner, he's, you know, like going, ah, we're going to make games shorter. We're going to like involve different plays to make gameplay quicker. We're going to mess with these traditions of American pastimes, a beloved American pastime. We're just going to mess with it because ratings have been down. Oh, what about doing something like recognizing and adequately punishing players in the NFL that assault women, or perhaps doing something meaningful to curb concussions. I don't know. It's just an idea I'm floating out there. It might not be the speed of gameplay. It might be the incredible amounts of disgust that the average football fan has with the NFL in general. Go on. What else?
Steve Bannon has been removed.
Another thing that happened when we got off the air. Like, it was Steve Bannon's off the National Security Council.
Yeah.
There's a big power struggle between Bannon and a couple of other peoples behind the scenes in the White House. And, he's been removed from the National Security Council. He can now go back to his previous job. Scooby-Doo villain before the mask comes off. Go on.
Aw. President Trump said Bill O'Reilly is a good man and doesn't think he did anything wrong.
Yeah, in Sexual Assault Awareness Month? What was the month of awareness that we're in?
Yeah, April.
Yeah. It was like, he was like, yeah, Bill O'Reilly, you'll be fine. Oh, what's this? I'm just getting a late breaking news bulletin. Yeah, this just in.
You got 2 minutes to do it. So.
Yeah, Trump's next move is pardoning Bill Cosby. Go on.
Oh, several sections of Neil Gorsuch's book about assisted suicide were reportedly plagiarized.
Yeah. He said he's against assisted suicide and then elaborated, I do not like it, Sam I am. Go on.
Michelle Obama is scheduled to speak later this month at an architecture conference in Orlando.
Yeah.
Hear that, Orlando?
Yep, I think the attendees are excited to hear what she has to say about architecture. Even more excited that she's not the one planning the lunch menu, but nevertheless excited to hear what she has to say about architecture. Go on.
April 5th was National Walking Day.
Yeah, someone was like, hey, did you celebrate the national holiday? I was like, what national holiday? Like, April 5th, National Walking Day. Or as me and many other Americans called it, Wednesday. it's another waddling, buttery summer. Go on.
A children's clothing line is being recalled due to choking and laceration hazards.
Yeah. So if you have any items from the Adrian Peterson Little Tykes line, please return them immediately.
Come on with that.
Well, no, I mean, like, let's be real here. It's, again, in the world of professional football. By the way, like, my full name is Adrian, and whenever I go to fill in any form on my phone, I don't know what it is, because I'm not like an Adrian Peterson fan or someone that really cares. Like, he's from, like, he's a Houstonian that played for, I think the last time I checked, the Minnesota Vikings. But like, every time I put in Adrian in my phone to like fill out some sort of whatever the hell it is, Peterson automatically pops up afterwards. I'm like, whose phone do you have this confused with, Google? But again, another example of like, he did some horrible, horrible things to his children. And because he's reasonably good at football, he seems to be able to skate on that. And that, my friend, well, Roger Goodell is not actually my friend, but that, Roger Goodell, is perhaps why your ratings are suffering. When you are complicitly guilty of something as horrible as that, when you are complicit in someone's, I'm not finding the words, it's Monday, but bottom line is, child abuse bad, NFL also bad.